When the United States Constitution was written, they all gathered together and they started to try to hash out the details, and all they could do was argue. And so they were told, "I have an idea," by one of the leaders, "let's go and pray." And they all marched out and they went to a nearby church and got on their knees for 2 solid hours and prayed. And when they came back, everything just flowed and they wrote the Constitution without a hitch. America was founded on godly principles, and its laws were taken directly from the Word of God. If you don't believe that, you can take the Code of Virginia or the United States Constitution or anything and take your Bible and look and see where they got it. And the Constitution was only good for a godly people. Matter of fact, one of the founders said that it won't work for anybody but a godly people, and we found that out. The fantastic, great Patrick Henry, my favorite founder, said that he feared that one day an evil and corrupt Supreme Court would pervert the Constitution and make it mean things that it wasn't intended to, and he was right. And just this week, we saw the president and the vice president in a prayer meeting with no evangelical leaders, no Bible-believing pastors, but 2 what they call transgender pastors, whatever the heck that is, and a turncoat Jewish rabbi trying to bless them. And all they could pray about was that God would do away with white people, moral decency, and the Constitution. My God, how far have we fallen? But you know, I know the first thing we want to do, we want to blame the political parties. We want to blame the Democrats for being so wicked and the Republicans for being so stupid. But you know, we don't want to hear this, but the fault lies with the church. Churches that have turned their heads ever since Madeline Mary O'Hare, who, by the way, is in the pits of hell this morning, and she is a believer more than anybody else in here. She believes. She stepped up and got the Supreme Court to remove prayer from schools. Now, I'm old enough. When I went to public school, I went to Monroe Elementary. We had to pray every morning. A child was selected to read a devotional every morning. We stood and saluted the flag and pledged allegiance, and then a child would pray every morning. But then they said, that's going to scar people if we keep doing that. And it looks like it scarred people because we don't do it no more. We turned our back on God's and we let this one woman remove prayer from schools, and the churches sat there wringing their hands, looking at the floor, and never said a word. And then just a few years later, they decided they want to make it legal to kill babies in the womb, and now even our illustrious governor said he'll kill them out of the womb. The church did nothing. It just sat there and said, you know, we don't want to get involved in politics. Well, the devil's people did while we sat there, and we let them do it. And on and on and on, there's more laws have been passed and more sexual immorality going on in this country than you can shake a stick at, and the church allowed it and even allowed people in the church to do it. I know this is not popular, what I'm going to tell you, but I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm very unpopular most of the time for telling the truth, and that's all right. I don't care, because I only answer to the Lord on that one. But in Ezekiel chapter 22, the Lord came to the prophet Ezekiel and talked to him about doing the same thing of speaking up. And it said, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, now thou son of man, will you judge? Will you judge the bloody city? Yea, thou shalt show her all her abominations. And you know, we failed to do that. We want to quote Matthew 7:1, judge not that you be not judged, but I'll be doggone, we don't want to read the rest of the chapter what it says. The Bible says to judge righteously. If there was no such thing as judging, you couldn't preach anymore. You couldn't read the Bible anymore, because the Word of God judges me every time I look at it. It judges you every time I look at it. It's time for a little judgment, because God's judgment is getting ready to fall on this nation. And I'm afraid the church is going to get a little of it too, because we allowed it to happen. He said, you will show the bloody city all her abominations. You're going to tell them what they did wrong. That's where the prophets come in. Now, I was told in one of the seminaries that I went to one time, I've been to several, that we don't have prophets no more. And I found out why they said that, because nobody wants to grow a spine and go tell the leaders of this nation what they're doing wrong. So we'll wish away the prophet thing. We don't need those no more. But I think we need them worse than we've ever needed them since the beginning of time. Nobody wants to be a real prophet. They want to get on TV and tell you about all the good stuff that's going to go on, and just to buy my book and buy my video and give me $29.95 and I'll fix everything for you. But I think about Elijah. Elijah had an Ahab and a Jezebel like we do. Oh, don't be looking at me all wounded like that. You know I'm telling the truth. Oh, he's stepping into politics. Oh, you ain't heard nothing yet. We need an Elijah to say, your sins are causing our nation to fall. Then I think of Nathan the prophet. He went to the great King David, who is the greatest king that has ever lived on this earth. At least the Lord thought so. And Nathan had committed adultery and murder to cover up the adultery. And one sin after another. And he'd done painted himself in a corner. And Nathan went and told him the story about a little lamb and this or that. And David got in a rage and said, whoever did that's going to die and repay fourfold what he took. And Nathan pointed his finger right in the great king's face and said, it's you. We need people that have guts enough to go to the leaders of this nation and say, it's you. You are guilty of this. But nobody wants to do it, because they're afraid they're going to wind up like John the Baptist. John the Baptist got his head cut off for telling the king, it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. But he told the truth. We need more of them. The Bible's full of prophets, and none of them made big money, and none of them were revered and paraded around as being the greatest thing. They were hated by everybody, because here they come again. They're going to say something that's going to hurt my feelings. It's past time we need our feelings hurt, folks. God wants to use the church mightily. And I've seen things happen lately in our little local church that has floored me. It's so amazing what God is doing, and he's answering prayers and doing miracles. But he wants to do that with everybody. And he wants to restore us back to the days of the early church. And if you want to see what the power that the church had in its early days, read the book of Acts. And don't let no infidel ever tell you that you can't do none of those things anymore, because Jesus said, greater things are you going to do. But you've got to return to the faith that the early church had, and they stood up to sin and they told it like it was, and everybody needs to start doing that. God told Ezekiel, say this, thus saith the Lord God, the city sheddeth blood in the midst of it, that her time may come, and maketh idols against herself to defile herself. You've become guilty in the blood that you've shed, and have defiled yourself with your idols that you've made, and you've caused thy days to draw near, and art come to thy years. Therefore have I made thee a reproach unto the heathen and a mocking to all the countries. That was at one time, because the churches in this land were strong, that the world feared the nation that the church lived in. Now we are a joke. We truly are. And I'm going to tell you what the national sin is. The sin that has set us so far back, that is the sin of abortion. Amen. We have killed 60 million babies since 1973 in this nation alone. And now we're sending money overseas so they can start their abortions back up again too. And now you taxpayers are going to pay for people's murders in this country. Now, if you think God can bless America having said that, you're out of your mind. He is obliged not to bless America until the churches stand up and say no more, and we put a stop to it. Well, how in the world are you going to do that? Voting don't work. No, it don't. You can holler, well, we got to vote for the right ones. Well, I don't even know who they are anymore. Voting ain't going to do it. Getting right with God is what will do it. Amen. And you go to everyone else and you witness to them and you talk to them about getting right with God. And I guarantee you, if America was to get right with God, there would be people getting in boats going across the Rappahannock as fast as they could to get out of here. But that requires work, and that requires sacrifice, and that requires us getting off of our behinds and getting down on our knees. That's what it requires. And living right and obeying the word of God. And it starts with a small group. But abortion has become our national sin. And we are no longer a Christian nation. We're worshiping the god Molech. Read up on that and see what they did. That happened back in the days of Ezekiel. That happened in the days of Jonah. He said, behold, the princes of Israel, every one in thee to their power to shed blood. And then he goes on to say the second sin that's part of our nation. He said, you've discovered your father's nakedness in thee. You've humbled her that was set apart for pollution. One hath committed abomination with his neighbor's wife, and another hath defiled his daughter-in-law, and another his own sister. Right now in America, any sexual perversion is okay. Whatever you want to be, whatever you want to do, there is no repercussions whatsoever from the law for doing that. None whatsoever. You can wake up one morning and decide that you don't want to be a man no more. I think a whole lot of people are doing that. A bunch of cowards don't want to be a man. It ain't easy being a man, I'm going to tell you. Ain't easy being a woman. But you need to be what God made you to be. Quit acting like you're something else. And now they can run up into schools and go in the girls' bathrooms and do whatever they want. They're destroying anything to do with girls' sports. They can't play because the boys want to play now. They've lost their minds. And now I think it's really laughable. The feminists are getting mad because the president said there's no such thing as the sexes anymore. Everybody's all the same. And the feminists and all their 50 years of hard work is washed right down the drain. And now they hate Biden too. Isn't that cool? When God created people male and female, And he gave us roles to play as that, but nobody wants to do that anymore. We just want to do all the perversions that we can possibly imagine. And he said, the house of Israel, in verse 18, has become like dross. They are brass and tin and iron and lead in the midst of the furnace, and they are even the dross of silver. And then he tells in verse number 24, son of man, say to her, this is the land that is not cleansed. And we're not cleansed. We cover up our sins with political correctness and by making it legal. And you can legalize whatever you want, but it's still illegal in this book right here. The land is not cleansed, nor rained upon in the day of indignation. He goes down the list. There is a conspiracy of her prophets in the midst thereof, like a roaring lion ravening the prey. They have devoured souls. They have taken the treasure and precious things and made many widows in the midst thereof. And then he lays into the pastors. I cannot begin to tell you the amount of pastors, prominent pastors, that said about wicked men and wicked women that we should not criticize them. We should pray for their success. Prominent pastors that if I named the names, your eyes would roll back so far in your head you'd look like a slot machine. Let me say this, and I pray to God some of you idiots are watching me. But if you pray for the success of those wicked people, in a couple of years from now, you will look just like the people of Venezuela gathered around a pile of trash in the middle of the street trying to find some food in it. That's what, if they are successful, that's what you're going to get. Do we pray for them? Yes, we pray for their souls that somehow they might see the light and get saved. But you do not pray for their success. You do not, it said that if you bid an evil person Godspeed, you are partakers of their evil deeds. Romans 1:32 said if you support them, you're guilty of what they do. Read the whole Bible, people. It'll unfit you from a whole lot of liberal preaching that you've heard. Here Ezekiel was told by God to say this to Israel. He said, your priests have violated my law. Your pastors have violated all the laws of God and have profaned my holy things, and they put no difference between the holy and profane. That is a pastor's job, to tell you what is holy and what is unholy. And the pastors back then wouldn't do it, and the pastors today won't do it either. That is why the members of these churches are so stupid. They're not being taught scripture. They're not being taught what thus saith the Lord. They're being taught whatever's popular to hear. Because they want to pack the church out and they want your money. I think it's a given that the more content you are with the way you're living, the more money you'll cough up, I guess. I don't know. I've never been involved in that, so I don't know. But that's what it looks like. They don't want to hurt nobody's feelings. Sometimes, though, I'd pay you money to hurt my feelings. I want to hear the truth. But they don't know the difference between the profane and the holy anymore. Neither have they showed difference between the unclean and the clean, and they've hid their eyes from my Sabbaths, and I'm profaned among them. Nobody's preaching and teaching the word of God to their people anymore. It's pop culture and smoke machines. Some of them believe that the Holy Spirit won't be in their church unless they got a smoke machine. Babylon Bee once said that the Holy Spirit quickly left the church because the smoke machine broke down. You don't need theatrics and special lights and smoke machines for the Holy Spirit to come in. Do what is right and he will. Welcome him in and he will. Then it said her princes in the midst thereof are like wolves, ravening the prey to shed blood and destroy souls and to get dishonest gain. A professional criminal has two paths he can take in life. Number one, he can get caught. Number two, he can get reelected. And that's what our princes, if you will, are doing. They go to the highest bidder. Whatever corporation pays them money is what laws they will pass. And all they want to do is shed blood and push more legislation to kill more babies and to commit more abominations. And they are totally corrupt. Only a fool would look to the nation's leaders for help. We need to be standing in front of them and saying, "You are the man. You did it." But nobody wants to do that because that's uncomfortable. But our leaders, all the way from local counties all the way to the White House now, most of them are totally corrupt. So don't look to them to help. Don't look to the half of the pastors of the land anymore, because they're not preaching and teaching the word of God. And then it said her prophets, and these are the evangelists, and these are the ones that's supposed to go around and tell what thus saith the Lord and tell you what's going to happen. Her prophets have daubed them with untempered mortar, seeing vanity and divining lies, saying, "Thus saith the Lord God," when the Lord hath not spoken. Today you can turn on your TV to some of these modern day prophets, and they will tell you what you want to hear. But they will not tell you what you need to hear. They will make up lies and say, "The Lord told me this and the Lord told me that," when he said no such thing. Most of the stuff that our modern day prophets are telling does not match up with the word of God. Let me explain this. Doesn't matter whether it's a pastor, doesn't matter whether it's a prophet, doesn't matter if it's a singer. If what they are singing or preaching or teaching or preaching about doesn't match up with this, they are lying. That's what they're doing. They are lying. Do not buy into it. God never says that he's going to do this or do that where it's not consistent with what he wrote thousands of years ago. It always matches up with the scripture. This is the perfect word of God. But the prophets are divining lies and saying God said this, and behold, this is going to happen, and it's not going to happen. They're not telling you what's really going to happen. So you can hardly even look at them anymore. And then the people of the land, the congregations around the land, have used oppressions and exercised robbery and have vexed the poor, needy, and oppressed the stranger wrongfully. The congregation of a church is only as good as the pastor is. And they learn when he's teaching and preaching, and the other pastors and so forth, when they're teaching, preaching, that's how the congregation learns stuff. But I say this, today you need to read your Bible for yourself. Because you're going to find something that's getting said from the pulpit that ain't right. Need to do that, because you can't trust that anymore either. It's getting so bad. And don't be part of the wickedness that's going on. I just couldn't believe how that things could actually be going on in this nation until I heard what the rank and file members of local churches had to say. And I looked at Don and I said, "Now I know why we're in trouble." They don't know what in the world is going on and don't care to know, because nobody's telling them the truth. And here Ezekiel, just like we are today, was in a quandary. He said, "I sought for a man among them. Of all these people, I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it." God was looking for one person. One person in the entire nation that would make up a hedge and stand between God and the people and said, Lord, I'll make a stand. I'll stand here and I'll do what I can to stop this. I will talk to them. I will preach to them. I will prophesy to them. He said, I looked everywhere for one person to stand in the gap for the land that I should not destroy it, but I found none. Can God find one now? Can he find somebody that'll say, I don't know what necessarily I can do, but I'm going to do what you tell me to do. I'll stand in the gap. I'll say, God, please don't destroy our church, our community, our nation. I will stand here until you take me out. Amen. Can he find one that'll do it? Or will they go, you know, I got things to do and I can't. Well, here's the end result if we don't. God said, therefore, have I poured out my indignation upon them. I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath. Their own way have I returned upon their heads, saith the Lord God. Folks, when God told Solomon in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will repent from their ways and from their wicked ways and turn toward me, then I will heal their land. No need to go around saying, God bless America, but God save America. Yes. Folks, in this year, we're going to have to work harder than we ever had. Mm-hmm. We've got more people to reach. We've got more people to witness to. There are people that desperately need to be saved before God comes and yanks his church off this planet. I believe it's going to be very, very, very soon. But we need to get out there and warn people. We need to start living right. We need to stop neglecting the things of the Lord that are important and start focusing on that. That should be the primary thing in your life, is the things of the Lord. What he wants you to do. Everybody in here can be part of this, no matter how lowly you may think you are. Everybody in here can wake up in the middle of the night and get on their knees and pray. Everybody can do that. Have you not seen what has resulted from people in the church doing that? I sat across the table from the doctor when we were consulting about Nick. And the doctor said, let him die. He's too far gone. He can't live. He can't make it. Everything is destroyed in his body. Let him go. And his wife said, no, not. Not going to do it. They said, there's no way he could possibly survive. He said, I have to tell people this every day. He said, I know this is not what you wanted to hear, but I don't care what I had to hear from him. It's what we have to hear from God. Amen. And this church got busy praying. I saw people that have never done it before praying all night over this situation.